No one has more state pride than New Mexicans. The vibrant culture, bold flavors, unique history, and dramatic landscapes under our Zia sun are like no other. And the people of New Mexico are a rare breed. As diverse as we are, together we breathe life and soul into this high desert land, a land that promises adventure. I'm Michael Newman, and as your host, I'll be taking you with me as I seek out the best the Land of Enchantment has to offer.
New Mexico, it feels like home to me. It feels so true. It's time well spent when I spend it.
Thanks for tuning in for another episode of New Mexico True Television. I'm your host, Michael Newman. In this episode, we seek out some of the best farm experiences to be had throughout the year, a new adventure with every season. From feeding baby goats to you-pick orchards and navigating a corn maze, life on the farm is an extraordinary one. A little over 2 hours northeast of Las Cruces off Highway 82 is Runyon Ranches. In addition to the farm staying in strong supply of fruits, preserves, and fresh cider, tucked in back is a beautiful pond for trout fishing and a petting zoo. Roaming free on the property is a full menagerie of animals. And as adorable as each critter is, one of the most endearing qualities of this place is the dynamic among them. This is truly a place where everyone seems to get along, and they are just as friendly with their human visitors. It is a petting zoo after all.
Hey there.
Hi, welcome to Runyon Ranches.
Thank you. It seems like you guys have quite the operation going here. I saw some exotic animals that I don't think I've ever seen in New Mexico before.
No, probably not, and maybe especially that you can put your hands on.
Yes, okay, so you can pet them and feed them.
Definitely.
And stuff?
Definitely.
Can you show me around a little bit?
Sure, I will give you a personal tour.
Oh, I like it. Let's do it. Come here, buddy. Yeah. Oh, there we go.
So hey,
this is quite the job you have created for yourself. This is so awesome to getting to work with these animals. How did you even think to want to do this?
We were ranchers, and so we always had doggy animals, you know, orphan animals that we needed to raise on a bottle. And when I graduated from college and had a job and decided to get married and come home, my mom said, Here's all the doggies, you're gonna raise them. So they were in my yard, which is right behind the stand.
Okay.
And people are always wanting to pet and feed them.
Right.
And I didn't want a bunch of people in my yard. So I built a pen to the side and just put them in there. And then somebody said, we have a llama that really needs a home. Will you take it? Or we have a pig that needs a home. Will you take it?
Oh,
and
my
so
goodness.
It just turned into a zoo.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't know, but did promptly found out that we needed a license. So we are USDA federally inspected and licensed. And as you can see, it has grown into this amazing place, and it's constantly growing, and it is a work in progress.
Right.
It is 24/7.
But it's gotta be gratifying at the same time to have like these animals that just come up to you and just love on you, and just, they all seem like they have different personalities.
They do, and everyone's like, how do you remember all their names? They're all very individual.
There definitely are some characters around here, I will say that. Two of the most popular of them being Runyon and Wallace, a camel and an Asian water buffalo who can always be found side by side.
So now we're off to meet Runyon and Wallace.
Right, the unlikely pair.
The unlikely pair, for sure. They're twins, they think. The only thing about matching up two opposite animals is Runyon's life expectancy is about 60 to 70 years.
Wow.
And Wallace's is maybe only about 25 to 30. So I am a little bit worried about what will happen to Runyon when Wallace goes, because unfortunately I can't make him live forever.
right, and they get so attached.
Maybe I'll have to find a new water buffalo.
Right, hopefully. That's crazy. Yeah. The animals get attached like that.
That is one thing I think people notice around here a lot, is they always are commenting to me on how it is so amazing how everyone just gets along here. And they do. It's amazing to have you. I usually just throw a wide variety of animals together and they work it out.
Figure it out, guys. Come back in a couple days.
Clearly the animals have worked it out. This place genuinely feels like a utopia in that regard. Something we can all aspire to. And the peaceful quality here could make you decide to stay a while.
This is just such a different experience that's healing for anybody, you know?
Right.
There's something just very universal about animals, especially in an environment where they're just roaming free. You know, it's very unassuming driving down the road, you know, and you don't expect to see this.
You don't expect it. You know what happens when you're driving out to here, Michael, is you're thinking, where is the next restroom, right? And you're looking anywhere and you're like, that tree's looking kind of good. But then you see one of our signs that says clean restroom. So you stop, and I don't know how many people from all over the country that have stopped and said, we never knew this place was here. We stopped to use the restroom, right. And this was the best place on our vacation.
Yes, best pit stop you can make. Actually, I'll share this with you. When I walked up and I saw two goats and I saw two pigs and I saw two,
Noah's Ark.
Yeah, Noah's Ark. I'm like, where are these guys going and where can I go to? Like, it was a funny experience.
So, it is. It's definitely an oasis on Highway 82.
An oasis indeed. If only everything in life felt this simple and harmonious. But when you need a dose of it, you know where to come. And Runyon and Wallace will be waiting out front to greet you. The fish in the pond are just as excited to be fed as the critters on land. Don't forget to get food for them. And there are more animals beyond these gates. Be on the lookout for elk and wild horses on your drive in, and be sure and drive slow. Coming up, we're headed up to High Rolls.
Do you take a lot of pictures on your New Mexico travels? Well, if you do, show us by hashtagging New Mexico True on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Just over an hour northeast of Las Cruces on US 70 East are High Rolls and Mountain Park. Home to Cadwallader's mountain farms and cherry orchards, this lush patch of land operated as the fruit basket for the region for many years. And their U-pick fields during cherry season are still relished by visitors to this day.
Good morning.
Morning, how are you today?
Good, I'm here to pick some cherries.
Alrighty, these are your cans. They hold about 4 pounds. Okay. The buckets hold about 12.
Opting for the smaller pail, I head for the fields. The orchard is already bustling. Through the leaves, I get glimpses of kids and trees, sightings of arms and hands reaching through the branches, accompanied by giggles and banter as the day's cherry pickers harvest the abundance of fruit hanging from the trees above.
Morning.
And despite the number of people already here, this orchard is anything but crowded. I make my way down the rows until I find a tree that appears to be calling my name, one with a ladder already in place. This tree yielded a pretty decent haul. Upgrading to a larger bucket, I decide to check out another corner of the orchard with more cherry varietals.
This is the gold mine right here.
Here we go. This looks promising.
Yeah. Ten different clusters. Come on. Give it to me. Yeah.
That's a good day's work right there, if I do say so myself.
I think I picked my weight in cherries.
Before I go tally my day's pickings though, I want to grab a word with the farmer behind it all.
We're here in this beautiful cherry orchard, and it seems like it's a nice, serene, peaceful place to be, but there's a lot of food to be picked. So I'm just wondering how long you guys have been doing this here.
We've been doing the U-pick since 1943. My grandfather started because there was no help during World War II. Mm-hmm. All the men were at war.
Right.
And so he had a big crop and opened it to the public, and we've been doing it ever since. So we've owned this piece of property since about 1902.
Wow.
It came in pretty early at the turn of the last century.
That's crazy, but it's always been cherries?
They've kind of done cherries and fruit, and they used to grow cauliflower and broccoli, and they also grew flowers and shipped them to Dallas.
So they were kind of entrepreneurs, you know,
right.
Beginning.
A farmer always grows what he can make the best money out of.
Right.
While the crops may not be as diverse as the early 1900s, Cadwallader's peaches, apples, and other fruits keep this operation going, all of which you can buy at the farm stand if you don't pick it yourself. And just a bit further up the road is another main attraction, the Old Apple Barn. This old barn turned emporium is a one-stop shop for treats of every kind. Harkening back to the old mercantile stores and emporiums of yesteryear, every item is packaged and presented to evoke classic Americana. And I hope you saved room, because they also serve up some good old-fashioned desserts, all of which they make from scratch upstairs. When I arrive, Bill and his son Hunter are hard at work making candied apples and pecan praline.
So Bill, how would you describe the old apple barn? Because there's a lot of moving pieces, it seems.
Well, it used to be the new apple barn in 1941. Well, they processed the apples on the top floor. And once they were clean, sized, and graded, they were put into boxes and slid down a galvanized slide. Mm-hmm. And then they would go out a sidetrack for the old-fashioned train.
Oh, so the railroad that kind of...
It had a sidetrack right 4 feet from the building.
Wow.
Yeah. This elevation, called High Rolls and Mountain Park, had all the fruits and vegetables.
So it's kind of always been a mecca for produce and farming and those kind of things.
Yeah. After World War II, less young men, you know, they had seen Paris.
Right.
And so less of them came back. But there's still a component that's very active.
Right. And for you, why was it important to preserve that history?
Well, we're both from the Midwest, and we went to places like this as kids. Our parents would take us to places like this. We loved it. And we thought, this is perfect. It's an historic apple barn, but it's in the Southwest. And so we kind of transported that sort of feeling into southern New Mexico.
So are any of the recipes special recipes that come from your family?
Absolutely. My older brothers were hunters, and I didn't like getting up in the morning. So I spent my time in the kitchen with my grandmother. She taught me how to make fudge, work with sugar. I have the lard crust because of her, which is the extra flavor. You got to have that.
Right.
And the pecan pies, we pack them with a cup and a half of pecans in each pie. So
no skimping on the pecans.
No. And we double bake all our crusts.
Oh,
no
man.
Soggy bottoms. You don't want that.
No soggy bottoms here. I think it's safe to say they've nailed it. Their must-try items are absolutely the classic root beer float, the pecan pie, and the homemade fudge, but that's just for starters. This is also the perfect place to grab a gift to take home with you. Books, culinary accessories, toys, you name it, they have it. And if you come down for the U-Pick cherries, the season generally starts in June. Up next, goats. Need I say more?
Do you need a reason to hit the road? Find out about upcoming events around the state at newmexico.org.
And now from the pages of New Mexico Magazine. Just under an hour east of Albuquerque, off New Mexico 41 South in Estancia, you will find the Old Windmill Dairy. This farmstead dairy is known for their premier artisanal goat and cow cheeses. The milk from these goats and their cow counterparts help create the award-winning Chèvre, Gouda, and Brie the dairy is known for. Today, I've signed up for one of their regular farm tours to check out their operation and meet the goats. Curious and playful and insanely cute, it's no wonder people are so drawn to goats and the dairy's tours.
We're gonna start here with the tour today. This side of the house is our milking side. This is where all the goats are that get milked. Everyone that has a collar has had kids, which we're gonna go see in a little bit, and they're producing milk. Most of our goats are Nubians. They have the long ears and they're originally from Nubian Egypt. So they did really well in the desert, and they produce a high butter fat, which makes awesome cheese.
Come on in.
Today's farm tour is centered around the new arrivals, the baby goats, who we're going to get to bottle feed here in a minute. They are so cute, I can hardly stand it.
All right, so we're gonna head in here and I'll show you how to bottle feed a baby goat.
I think these little guys know what's coming.
I don't think I look like your mama, but you seem to be convinced.
So, this is not Coke. This is their mother's milk we collected this morning from milking. It's nice and warm. They're all used to getting bottle fed, so it doesn't take much. But when you do feed them, you need to tilt it up so the milk goes down and the air goes up and they're not swallowing air. And usually if you just hold it in front of them, they will latch on. And if you like, you eat until they stop. You don't have to worry about overfeeding them.
Okay.
Cool, cool.
I feel like my motherly instinct is coming out, you know, that I didn't know I had.
Yeah, if you're having a stressful day, this just melts everything away.
Yeah.
With or without bottles in hand, the goats seem to like our company too. And once they latch on, it doesn't take long for these kids to down their mama's milk. But thankfully for us, snuggles and other affectionate gestures go hand in hand with the feeding, making it a little hard to leave them. but they're ready to get back outdoors and play, so we make moves for the creamery. Due to health codes, we do not go inside the creamery, but still get a good vantage point.
So what we're looking at right now, this is what we call the creamery, and this is where I like to say the magic happens. This is where we take the milk, we pasteurize it, and we turn it into a finished product. In this room is where everything takes place, from pasteurization to making the product to packaging, labeling, and sending it out the door. Our cheesemaker, Abby, is in here right now. You'll see her. She is working on some, what we refer to as the bloomy rinds. It's like the breeze, the blues, things like that. And those take a lot of attention. You gotta like work them every day of the week and give them some love and just make sure they're happy and they turn out to be wonderful.
So the goats aren't the only ones getting lots of attention. I had no idea that cheeses needed to be handled and given such care, but that must be why the end product tastes so good. Speaking of which, we head for the tasting room to sample some of these delectable cheeses.
Ooh, good.
Come on in here.
What a spread.
Thank you.
So how many different types of flavors and styles do you guys have?
I think there's a total of 36 different varieties and flavors of cheese. We started with just the Chèvre. We later added like the figs and cream because of a customer request. We started doing the Lavender Festival. So there's lemon, lavender, white chocolate.
What's been your top seller by far? What are people most in love with?
Well, for years we're known for Chili and Hot. It's
New Mexico.
Yeah, it's won 4 or 5 SCOVY Awards at the Fiery Food Show. Oh. The Chipotle has won a couple of SCOVY Awards, and it's a nice smoky Chipotle.
It goes from the range of breakfast stuff to maybe some more dessert-related items. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cool, well, I want to dig in. You guys ready?
Yeah, so on the table, please help yourself.
That's all the invitation we need. Time to dig in. When it comes to food, this is not a situation where you help yourself before assisting others. Get those kids some cheese.
Oh, how about that?
I get excited when people come out here and they actually see where their food comes from, and especially the kids. And it's really neat because nowadays there's not a lot of small farms around, and people really aren't connected back to their farmer like it used to be. And honestly, these animals are the greatest therapist around. I mean, they just can calm you down and keep you happy, and yeah, it's a good balance.
Yeah. They have that much more connection and understanding of their food. Yeah. And then that's the next generation of people that are gonna be buying these products, you know, investing in local farmers, in the local food chain, right?
I'm a nurse, a nurse practitioner, and I think what we do is produce healthy, nutritional cheese, which I believe is a good staple, and I love it.
Tours happen throughout the year, but the baby goat tours happen in late February into March. It's all up to Mother Nature. They also do cheese making classes for all you aspiring cheesemongers. And be sure and ask Ed for the best way to prep their green chili cheese curds. For more great stories like this from New Mexico Magazine, visit newmexico.org. Stay tuned to be amazed. And now, here's another New Mexico true treasure.
Hi, I'm Vanessa, and I think McCall's Pumpkin Patch is a New Mexico true treasure. Every year when it's fall in New Mexico, there are always so many activities, but for us, McCall's Pumpkin Patch experience has become a family tradition. It is such quality family time, and for parents, it's a nice time because we're all together and we're not worrying about the kids being on their screens or trying to find something to entertain them. It's all built in. We saw a pig race, and there were tons of crowds there cheering each different pig on. That was lots and lots of fun. I think my son said that's the first time he's seen a pig. And then a new addition this year was the Princess Castle. My daughter was able to get a princess makeover, and she really thought some of those princesses were magic. The best part about McCall's Pumpkin Patch is that every year they add something new, and so we can't wait to go back next year and see what's waiting for us.
Bordering Albuquerque to the north is the village of Corrales. In this verdant stretch of the Rio Grande Valley, agriculture is still a way of life. And in the case of Wagner's farmland experience, visitors get to reap the bounty. Case in point, their corn maze. Each year, a new labyrinth is cut, beckoning you to weave and wander through it, getting lost among the stalks. Don't mind if I do. For those more ambitious, you may decide to time yourself and see how quickly you can make it through the maze. But for the rest of us, taking the time to meander through cornfields on a cool autumn day is reward enough. From here, we'll show you the abridged version, since I opted to approach the labyrinth as they did in ancient times, in a very serene spiritual manner, aka moving very slowly. While the corn maze is an American phenomenon, labyrinths date back to the 5th century BC, and while the symbolism has changed over the ages, their appeal has remained a constant. A wise man once said, "All those who wander are not lost." And as I'm inclined to say, not all those who are lost in a corn maze mind it one bit. From there, I head over to the petting zoo. After all, you can't visit a farm like this without making some furry friends. And for the kiddos, a chance to learn about the different animals and their jobs at a working farm is all part of the fun.
So Jim, how long have you guys been doing this at the farm?
We've started this 10 years ago. Wow. This is our 10th season this year.
When it's not corn, what kind of crops are you guys growing here?
Well, we do a lot of different varieties of pumpkins and squashes and cucumbers, melons. We do that earlier, and then we put corn for the October.
And then I saw there's some roosters there, so you got some chilies going here too?
Oh yes, we raise all kinds of chili.
And today, you got kids everywhere. So what's the experience for you as the owner?
Just enjoyable to see the kids to come out to a farm and see where the food is grown, and we give them an education of all that. So, you know, they don't think it's just from a supermarket.
Right.
They see it firsthand, how we grow it and harvest it.
The Farmland Experience operates from mid-September to Halloween each year. And year-round, you can enjoy dishes showcasing Wagner's crops at their Apple Tree Cafe, also a stop on the Breakfast Burrito Byway. Thanks for joining me in my farmland adventures, where new experiences and some new friends are always awaiting you. With that being said, what are you doing next weekend?